Well, friends, good afternoon and welcome back to the course on Geotechnical Engineering 1. You remember we were dealing with compaction of soils, and I told you the importance of compaction of soils, where all you use compaction and what are its main application areas. We were discussing on the principles, definition and principles of compaction. Let's continue further. In today's class, the objective is to learn the principles of compaction, basically the distinction between compaction and consolidation. My colleague Professor Dinesh talked about consolidation. We shall see how different is compaction from consolidation. Then we shall focus on the laboratory methods of determination of compaction. So there are two major tests, standard Proctor's test and modified Proctor's test. Wherever possible, we will have the numerical problems and their solution. When we discussed about compaction in the last class, I told you that it is most important to strengthen the soil, most important to make the soil stiff, strong and durable. And it is a mechanical process. What you do is to densify the soil, thereby you are going to reduce the volume occupied by the soil mass, which is done by removing air, expelling out air. You know, soil is a three-phase system consisting of soil solids, water and air. Air will be expelled out during compaction, which is a relatively easier process. So we discussed in the last class that the compaction is the reduction in the volume due to expulsion of air, which is done by some mechanical process. You can consider soil particles like this, having solids and voids, voids filled maybe partially with air and partially with water. And when you apply some vibratory force or some mechanical force, you intend to expel out air and bring the soil to this form. The gap here which you see is due to the expulsion of air, therefore the volume of the soil mass gets reduced. So please note here, in the three-phase system, the volume of solids will remain, volume of water also will remain as it is, but volume of air is reduced. The quantity of air reduced will reduce the overall quantity of soil mass, and hence basically due to compaction the soil mass will become denser. That part we will see now. As showed earlier, you have the soil particles consisting of solids and then voids filled with air and or water. So you have the three-phase system now: solids, quantity of water in the voids and quantity of air in the voids. Now you apply the mechanical process. It could be, you know, vibration, it could be some static pressure applied, it could be rolling, it could be kneading, and under this vibratory force and mechanical force, air present in the voids gets expelled out. So you see the situation like this, where the volume is reduced. Volume is reduced because of the expulsion of air, but the solids and water will remain intact. Only the quantity of air gets reduced. So if W is the weight of the soil mass before compaction, even after compaction, the weight of the soil mass will remain W only. Why? Because we assume that the air has no weight, because the solids and water will remain intact. And what about the volume? The volume of the soil mass will be V1 initially, but volume of soil mass V2 will be much reduced after compaction. So V2 is smaller than V1. Now if I find the density, maybe bulk density itself, density is equal to weight by volume. Initially density gamma B1 is equal to W by V1, but after compaction what happens? Density gamma B2 will be W by V2. W, the numerator, remains intact. What happens to denominator? It is changed from V1 to V2. It is changed from a bigger value to a smaller value, because volume is compressed, and hence density gamma B2 increases. So please note that due to compaction, gamma B2 density after compaction will always be greater than the gamma B1 density before compaction. Soil particles are moved closer to each other. The air in the void space is expelled out. The number of contacts between the particles is increased. Hence, higher the density, I told you that due to compaction, density is increased. Higher the density, stronger, stiffer, and more durable will the soil mass be. So, in order to make the soil stronger, stiffer, and more durable, we need to compact the soil. So, whenever we see that the soil is loose, soil has low strength, soil is likely to experience large settlement, we intend to compact the soil, thereby increasing the density, which in turn will increase the strength, stiffness, and make the soil mass more durable. Again, this picture also shows what happens after compaction. You have a loose soil consisting of the solid particles and the voids, which will be filled with air and or water. And once you do the compaction, the process of compaction involves mechanical exertion, which may be, you know, static pressure applied, vibratory pressure force applied, rolling, tamping, kneading, whatever it is. And under this, these particles are brought together. Air present in the void is expelled out, and after compaction you see a situation like this. So what is happening here? The voids are reduced, the number of contacts between the particles is increased tremendously. Once the number of contacts is increased, the friction between the particles is increased and angle of friction also increases. Thereby strength increases, bearing capacity increases, and so many plus points happening we shall discuss in future. Sometimes we intend to explain the compaction principles through this graph. On the vertical axis you have the unit weight of soil, density of soil, maybe you can say bulk density of soil, and on the horizontal axis you have the water content. Initially, when the soil is dry, you have the dry soil with this bulk density, but then afterwards when you start adding water at the same time compacting the soil, that volume will be occupied by more and more soil, therefore the density keeps on increasing. Water is continuously added, so whatever you see here is the water, and because you are adding water which acts like a lubricant, because you apply mechanical force, the soil particles come closer and closer, and hence more and more particles are added in the same volume space. So what happens to density? The density keeps on increasing. The bulk density also, it keeps on increasing till certain stage beyond which any further increase in the water might not show the same amount of increase, and interestingly, you know, the bulk density is likely to decrease also. Surely the dry density is definitely going to decrease. So that part we are going to see. So you see that with increase in water, the bulk density or dry density increases up to certain stage only, beyond which you see a decreasing trend. So you have a peak value of density at a specific water content, which we are going to discuss in the coming slides. So what does compaction do? How does it influence the ground? One, as discussed earlier, it increases the density, and due to this the strength of the soil will increase. Why? Once the density is increased, the particles are brought closer and closer, thereby the number of contacts are increased, thereby the friction angle increases, and hence the strength increases. Automatically, once the strength increases and density increases, bearing capacity increases. When you go to the next semester, you will understand that bearing capacity is directly a function of strength of soil and density. More the density, more the strength, more will be the bearing capacity. Where do you use this term? bearing capacity, or more precisely safe bearing capacity, is one of the important parameters in the design of foundations. So whenever you want to build a foundation, if the soil has not got adequate strength, adequate bearing capacity, if you do the compaction, you are likely to increase the bearing capacity, and hence the soil may be fit enough to take the load. So you, after compaction, the bearing capacity increases. Further, the compaction results in decreasing the settlement. You know, settlement is an important feature, which again we are going to discuss in the next semester. And you had a glimpse of it in consolidation theory. So if at all a soil is loose, and when you apply in more load due to the construction of the structure, the soil may undergo settlement. The settlement causes undesirable effects, and it may even cause failure of the structure. So settlement is definitely not desirable. And one of the main reasons for the settlement is void space. Compaction will reduce the voids, thereby the settlement is also decreased. Then automatically decreased settlement, increased bearing capacity, increased density will lead to slopes being stable, embankments being stable. These are the two important geotechnical structures which we commonly come across, and you notice that both become stable. Slope becomes stable, so is the embankment. The other important aspect in soil mass is permeability. There are pores, and the pore space, which is filled with water or air, is likely to allow water to flow through it. Whenever there is a head difference from upstream to downstream, water can flow through the pore space, and automatically the permeability is a common feature in soil mass. Many a times permeability is undesirable. For example, earth dam. We don't want the earth dam to allow water to flow through it. We actually want the dam to store water on one side and see that it acts like an impermeable banner, barrier. And now if permeability is allowed, it becomes meaningless. So what do you do there? Whenever you build an earth dam, you think of good compaction to see that the permeability through the pores of the soil mass is as less as possible. So compaction reduces permeability. We don't have to worry about the frost action in Karnataka, maybe most part of India also. But frost action has a serious effect on several structures. Whenever in cold countries, during cold season, you have a lot of void space, especially void filled with water, then during cold season, water transforms into ice. What will happen then? Ice naturally increases the volume, thereby the soil mass will expand. You just imagine you have a structure built on a soil mass which earlier was having water in the void space. Now it has got ice. What will happen? Automatically the volume of the soil mass will increase, thereby the structure, if at all it is very light, it might be lifted up also. So now, if at all you do compaction, what will happen? The amount of water present in the voids is reduced, thereby the frost damage also gets very much reduced. The more the compaction is, better will be the to withstand the damage during the frost action. In general, you will reduce the erosion. So quite naturally, the soil particles are packed together, they are dense, they have connection with each other, they have more number of contacts with each other, thereby any loose particle going out of the mass is very much reduced, and hence there is a good control of erosion. So compaction will reduce the erosion damage also. These are all some of the positive effects of compaction. So in general, compaction increases the dry density of the soil. So it for soil containing fines, well compacted soil has 1. High negative pore water pressure. Please note that in a fine grained soils, soil pores are likely to be filled with water, and if the water has got a positive pressure, automatically the effective stress, which is equal to the total stress minus the pore pressure, will always be reduced. But if at all you have a situation when the pore water is having the negative pressure or suction, what will happen to effective stress? That will increase. So effect of compaction is to reduce the positive pressure in the soil, in the water, or maybe to create suction in the pore water, thereby the pore pressure will become negative and hence the effective stress will increase. Even at the ground surface, there will be high effective stress if compaction is done, which means the strength will be high. So strength increases maybe due to the particle to particle contact increasing in granular soils, or due to the creation of suction pressure in the pore water in fine grained soils, thereby increasing the effective stress. Further, compaction also results in higher stiffness, which means lower compressibility, lower settlement. Higher strength results in higher bearing capacity, and also, as discussed earlier, the compaction results in reduced permeability. So these are some of the positive effects of compaction. 1. Strength increase. 2. Settlement decrease. 3. The permeability decrease. With this, let us try to see the distinction between compaction and consolidation. You were taught about consolidation in the previous classes, where it was mentioned that it is an important natural process happening in the soil mass, which, if not taken care, can lead to disasters. Maybe my friend talked to you about the Leaning Tower of Pisa, which is leaning because of the effect of consolidation. There are many structures which have failed because of consolidation. So we should avoid consolidation if it is beyond the permissible limits. Now, our focus is on distinguishing between compaction and consolidation. So let us try to see one by one what are the distinctive features in compaction compared to consolidation. 1. Please note that compaction is man-made. You use some mechanical means to compact. You compact to increase the density. You compact to increase the strength, increase the bearing capacity, reduce permeability, reduce settlement. So compaction is man-made, but more or less consolidation is natural. It is a natural process happening in the soil due to the expulsion of water. It's a long process taking days together, years, sometimes centuries. So consolidation is a natural process. What do you do in compaction? It is man-made, and you are going to decrease the volume in both the cases. In compaction, the volume is decreased by expulsion of air, whereas in consolidation, the volume is decreased by expulsion of water present in the pore space, expulsion of pore water. Naturally, expulsion of pore water takes a long time. It's not easy to expel out pore water. But air can be expelled out depending on the mechanical means you apply. Compaction is a natural process, is a man-made process, and it is a process which takes time in quick interval of time. It is a fast process. Maybe in a couple of days, couple of hours, you can expel out air, thereby you can make the soil compact. So it takes place very quickly. What about consolidation? As I mentioned to you earlier, being a natural process, it is very gradual. It takes place years for consolidation to completely get over, and there are instances which where it has taken centuries. So it is a gradual process. Compaction is possible in a soil which contains air. Please note, So it has to be a dry soil or partially saturated soil. If air is not present in the soil, if at all the soil is fully saturated, no way you can compact, because you know you just cannot expel out air at all. So you require air in the soil mass before compaction, and what is done is that air is expelled out. So it is possible in dry soil, it is also possible in partially saturated soils, but it is not possible in fully saturated soil, whereas consolidation is exactly opposite of that. It is possible only in saturated soil. If the soil contains air, then there is no excess pore water pressure to develop at all, thereby no consolidation at all. So consolidation can happen only in saturated soils like fat clay. So it is a process very different from compaction. Compaction results in increased density. What about consolidation? It also results in increased density due to dense packing. Please note that in compaction, air content is decreased from the state before compaction to a state after compaction. What about consolidation? There will be no air content even before or after consolidation, because you know it is fully saturated. So these are some of the distinctions between compaction and consolidation, and it is one of the common, very popular questions for the examiners. So be aware of it, and it carries 4 to 6 marks. So let us then see what exactly happens due to compaction. I take a state when the soil is completely dry, and when the soil is completely dry, it contains the solids and air. Void space is filled with air, and that soil, especially if it is clayey, it exists in flocculated form in its structure. What does it mean by this? That means, you know, you have the soil particles, particularly clay particles, which are plate like, having contacts with each other in this form, face to edge, like this. So there is always a repulsive force acting between the particles, and there is enough void space. Now when you add a little water to it, what will happen? Water will formulate a double layer. The water, being a dipole, is attracted towards the negative charged soil particles, and hence, you know, water forms a thin film on the soil particle. This thin film will allow some kind of lubrication, and hence allow the soil particles to delocate, so rearrange themselves. You add still more water will be utilized for the double layer to be filled, and hence, you know, the lubrication is increased. What will do, how will this lubrication help? This lubrication will help the soil particles to come closer and closer. So what will happen to dry density? With the increase in the water content, the dry density keeps on increasing. Further increase in the water content, then the dry density further increases. What is happening to air? Whatever air was present earlier, it is slowly expelled out. Why is it expelled out? Because you are applying some mechanical means. Maybe you are rolling, maybe you are tamping or kneading or applying some static pressure. So air is being expelled out and water is being simply added. So more and more water added, more and more lubrication continues. The particles try to rearrange, reorient themselves, and you reach a stage when the soil reaches its maximum dry density. So at some water content which is sufficient to have these particles filled with thin film of water, allowing sufficiently good lubrication, then you reach a stage when you have a water content corresponding to which you have a maximum dry density achieved. Any further increase in water content will not expel out air, because you know you have already expelled out all the possible air. Only when you apply much huger dynamic force, much huger mechanical force, maybe you can expel out some more air. Otherwise, with the same amount of compactive effort, perhaps this amount of air can never be expelled out, and any further increase in the water will simply increase the volume of the mass, which means volume increases at same dry density, dry weight, so the density decreases. It keeps on decreasing and decreasing. So you get a curve which has got a very significant peak, and water content less than this peak or water content more than this peak will show decreased dry density. So always in a compaction curve you have a curve something like this. So there are two important things you can find out from this. The water content corresponding to so one is the peak density, the maximum dry density, which we call as gamma d max or MDD, and water content corresponding to this MDD is called the OMC or optimum moisture content. So the objective of finding the conducting the compaction test is to determine the maximum dry density and corresponding optimum moisture content at a given compactive effort. Please note that initially when the water content is low, the soil will be in the flocculent stage or flocculated stage, where the contact will be between the edge and face like this. There is always some kind of a repulsion, but when you increase the water content, then slowly the particles try to transform to this particular stage, that is dispersed stage. So further increase in the water content, the soil will continue to remain in the dispersed stage. Only thing is, the void space is now being filled with water, so the particles are moved apart. So this is a stage when the particles are fully packed together, and hence the density will be maximum. So at this peak, the saturation level will be close to 100%, and anything beyond this, the saturation level of the soil mass will again continue to be close to 100%. But before this, soil will be more closer to dry state. So any water content before OMC is called the dry side of optimum moisture content, and any water content beyond the OMC is called the wet side of optimum moisture content. And what is required for us is, depending on the type of the construction, we need to decide whether to keep the water content on the dry side or on the wet side, or exactly at OMC. The advantage of keeping exactly at OMC is to achieve maximum density. Please note that all of them are functions of compactive effort. So this is a graph plotted at a specific compactive effort. If you either increase or decrease the compactive effort, then the curve will be very different. We shall discuss that later. So optimum moisture content is the moisture content at which the maximum possible dry density is achieved for a particular compactive effort. Please note, for a particular compaction energy. It definitely depends on the method of compaction also. The corresponding dry density is called maximum dry density. So please note that from the compaction test, you plot compaction curve. From the compaction curve, you are going to determine two things. Number one, OMC. Number two, MDD. OMC stands for optimum moisture content, and MDD stands for maximum dry density. Well, I explained to you why the curve will be like that. Let's again see the explanation as to why the curve takes that shape. It increases with increase in water content, reaches a maximum value, and then decreases. Please note, on the dry side of the optimum moisture content, clay soil shows high suction. Lumps are difficult to break, and hence they are difficult to compact. So there will be suction, plus there will be repulsion between the particles, thereby they show loose density, and it's very difficult to bring the particles closer. Increasing the water content you are going to reduce the suction, you are increasing the water in the double layer, you are making the lumps softer and you are lubricating the grains, thereby you are going to ease in compaction. So compaction becomes easier. As the water content increases, lubrication, thereby compaction also increases or improves, and hence the dry density achieved will become higher and higher. Now, nearly impossible to drive the last part of the air content. Any further increase in water content, what will happen to the dry density? Automatically it has to reduce. You have expelled out air slowly, continuously by adding more and more water, and air is expelled out because of the mechanical means. Up to one stage beyond which whatever compactive effort you are applying is not sufficient to expel out the air, you require a much higher effort. So that air content will remain intact further. Any further water added, what will happen? It will occupy the additional space. So void space increases, void ratio again increases, thereby increasing the volume or decreasing the dry density. So you have the reduced dry density. So curve follows down parallel to a maximum possible density which you can achieve, and that density we call as, you know, zero air void. That curve we call as zero air void curve. So maximum dry density and optimum moisture content, they depend on the compactive effort you apply, compaction energy you apply, and it is not unique to a soil. For sand, suction at low water content also prevents compaction, but not when the soil is completely dry. So in case of sandy soil, the curve will be slightly different and it follows the path as shown in the picture here. Again, we have plotted the dry density on the vertical axis and water content on the horizontal axis. When the soil is dry, it has got some density. Any further increase in water, the density decreases. Why? There will be some kind of surface tension and there will be repulsion due to this, and you reach a stage when that repulsion will be maximum. There is a thin film of water on top of the particles showing repulsion, and that point is called bulking of sand. At bulking of sand, volume will be maximum and hence dry density will be minimum. Further increase in water will reduce that bulking stage. Soil becomes saturated and then, you know, it becomes, you know, packed, densely packed. So you keep on seeing the increase in the dry density and it reaches a maximum, and any further increase in the water content may not hamper the dry maximum dry density. It's going to be almost the constant. So you don't see much variation in the dry density whether the soil is in the dry state or in the wet state in case of sand, and you will actually see some negative dry density or decrease in dry density initially, and it's going to be the minimum dry density at bulking level, and beyond which it keeps increasing. So this is the curve which you think of, okay, in case of coarse grained soils or granular soils. So in cohesionless soils, maximum dry density is achieved either when completely dry or when completely saturated. So when it is partially saturated, especially at the time of bulking level, the density will be lower. At low water content, grains are held together by suction. So water at grain contacts only, and this prevents compaction. Laboratory test on maximum dry density on sand requires full saturated sample, and you also may require it to be vibrated. Hence, water is added to the soil mass to lubricate it. The contact surfaces of the soil particles will be enhanced. So this improves the compressibility characteristics of the soil matrix. This improves the strength characteristics also of the soil mass. So water acts as a lubricant up to one stage only, beyond which further increase in water might not help much. With this, let us take up some numerical problems. I take the first problem, I read the problem. A laboratory compaction test on soil, we'll see what exactly is that laboratory compaction test little later, having a specific gravity of 2.7 gave a maximum dry density of 18 kilonewton per meter cube at a water content of 15%. Please note, maximum density is naturally MDD, and that water content corresponding to MDD is called OMC. So MDD is equal to 18 kilonewton per meter cube, OMC is equal to 15%. You need to determine the degree of saturation, you need to determine the air content, you also need to determine the percentage air void at maximum dry density. And then what would be the theoretical maximum dry density? Theoretical maximum dry density means it is the density when the air voids are completely expelled out. So strictly speaking, it is next to impossible to expel out the air completely. Only thing is, you can reach a stage closer to that by increasing the compactive effort. So let us see what will be the maximum dry density when the air content is completely zero. The data, G, specific gravity is 2.7, dry density gamma d is 18 kilonewton per meter cube, OMC corresponding to this gamma d is 15%. First step, we shall determine the void ratio. You are familiar with the equation gamma d equals G gamma w by 1 plus e. Gamma w, you can always assume gamma w is equal to 9.8 kilonewton per meter cube. So you know gamma d, you know g, you know gamma w, only unknown is e, which you can determine. So in this particular problem, the value of e is found to be 0.47. e is equal to 0.47. so that's how we determine the void ratio. Next, we'll determine the degree of saturation. We use the standard equation, wg is equal to se. W stands for water content, g stands for specific gravity of soil solids, s is degree of saturation which is required to be determined, and e is the void ratio. Previously we determined void ratio. We know w, water content, we know g, the only unknown is s. So we can determine s, the degree of saturation in this present problem is found to be 86.2%. Next, we shall determine air content. Air content is simply AC equal to 1 minus S, 1 minus of degree of saturation. So degree of saturation was 86.2%, and air content is 100 minus of that, which is equal to 13.8%. So with the present compactive effort, you are able to expel out the air to this level, but still 13.8% of the voids is filled with air. Now theoretical maximum is when air content is zero, when you completely expel out the air, and let us try to work out that. You know the equation gamma d equals 1 minus Na into g gamma w divided by 1 plus wg. Here Na refers to percentage air voids. Whenever the air content is zero, what will happen to percentage air voids? Automatically Na will also be zero. So for a theoretical maximum dry density, air content as well as percentage air void will be reduced to zero. Therefore gamma d will simply be equal to g gamma w divided by 1 plus wg. We know g 2.7, gamma w 9.8 kilonewton per meter cube, then w, the water content at OMC, we know, which is 15%. Substitute and you find out that the percent air voids Na will be 4.42%. So you can determine the percent air void, 4.42% in the first case. And secondly, when you want to find the theoretical maximum value, substitute Na equal to 0 in the equation and then find gamma d. Okay, let us quickly go to the next problem. I read the problem. A cohesive soil yields a maximum dry density of 18 kilonewton per meter cube at an optimum moisture content of 16%. So MDD is 18 kilonewton per meter cube, OMC is 16% during a standard Proctor's test. If G is equal to 2.65, what is the degree of saturation? Find out yes. What is the maximum dry density it can further be compacted to? That means the maximum theoretical dry density. So MDD is 18 kilonewton per meter cube, OMC is 16%, G is 2.65. These are the data which you are given. Like before, you can use this equation, gamma D equals G gamma W by 1 plus E. G is known, gamma D is known, gamma W can be assumed to be 9.8 kilonewton per meter cube, and hence only unknown E is determined as 0.442. Then to determine the degree of saturation, you use this equation, WG equal to S into E. W is water content, G is specific gravity, S is degree of saturation, and E is void ratio. You know WG and E, E was very recently found out. So knowing all these three, S can be determined, and in this problem S is equal to 95.9%. Then you have to determine the theoretical maximum dry density. That means dry density when the air voids are zero. So in the equation, gamma D equal to 1 minus Na G gamma W over 1 plus W G. Na is zero. So equation reduces like this. So you know G, you know gamma W, and then you know W. So you can find out the theoretical maximum dry density corresponding to zero air void. And you find this value as 18.24 kilonewton per meter cube, much bigger than 18 kilonewton per meter cube, which was determined in the, which was the case earlier. So this is the compaction curve for that air void previously determined. And then the theoretical value is 18.24, and this line is called zero air void line. This is the compaction curve with dry density on the vertical axis and the water content on the horizontal axis. So this is MDD, and corresponding to this on the horizontal axis, this is OMC. With this, let's quickly go to the laboratory tests. Maybe in the present class I may not be able to explain everything of the laboratory tests, but let us at least have some introduction to it. There are two major laboratory tests carried out. One is the standard Proctor's test and another is the modified Proctor's test. As the name itself indicates, the tests are same. Only difference is in modified Proctor's test, you are going to have an increased compactive effort put. Otherwise, the procedure remains the same, and we will just see as to why the name Proctor came into these tests. So these are the tests which are conducted to develop the compaction curve. So what are the major objectives of the laboratory tests? One, of course, to simulate the field condition. That is what is most important. In the field, you need to compact, and you should know how to compact in the field. What are the effective means? So laboratory test will give you certain data which will help you to do the field compaction. So to help in controlling the placement conditions in the field, so if you want to increase the dry density, what should be the water content to add, or what should be the dry density achieved at different water contents? So to control the placement condition in the field, you require to do the test in the laboratory. And you have to determine the proper water to be added to the soil. So mixing of water, the proper amount is to be decided, and for that you do the test in the laboratory. And you also can assess the amount of packing, the denseness you achieve in the field from the laboratory test. So these are some of the major objectives of compaction test in the laboratory. The fundamentals of compaction, especially of fine-grained soils, is relatively new. R.R. Proctor in early 1930s was building a dam, or building several dams, for the old Bureau of Water Works and Supply in Los Angeles, United States. And he developed the principles of compaction in a series of articles in Engineering News Record. In his honor, the standard laboratory compaction test which he developed is commonly called standard Proctor's test. and some modifications to this to increase the compactive effort has been named as modified Proctor's test. We shall see one by one what these tests have in store for us. First of all, standard Proctor's compaction test, and for that you can refer to IS 2720 part 7, the latest version is 1987. The apparatus you require include a cylindrical metal mold which comprises also of base plate. The internal diameter of the mold is 101.6 millimeter, height is 116.8 millimeter. So the volume, if you calculate pi by 4 d squared into h, will be 945,000 millimeter cube or 945 milliliters. It possesses a collar whose height is 50 millimeter. Then a rammer which has got a weight of 2.5 kg force or 25 newtons. And the rammer is so designed that it has got a height of fall of 305 millimeters, more precisely 304.8 millimeters. So these are the different equipments. One, the compaction mold with base plate and collar, the entire assembly. All these are separated here. This is the compaction mold. The diameter of the mold is here. The height of the mold is here, which I have already discussed. At the bottom, you have the base plate. So you can fix this compaction mold on the base plate and tighten them together, tie them together. Then on top of the mold, you are going to place the collar. The height of the collar is 50 millimeters. So these three put together is the compaction mold assembly, the compaction mold, base plate, and then the collar. And the rammer you use is this one. The when it is fully pulled up, it looks like this, and when it is brought down, it looks like this. The rammer is here. This is a guiding cylinder. You lift, you are going to place the rammer vertical, and you lift the rammer up to the top and release it, drop it vertically downwards. When you drop, the height of drop is actually 305 millimeters. So these put together will give you the equipments required for compaction. We shall in our next class discuss in more detail or discuss about the compaction test. So what we have so far seen is the apparatus, then the IS code 2720. The apparatus consists of the mold, the base plate, the collar, put together the mold assembly, and then the rammer. The weight of the rammer is 25 newtons. The height of drop is 305 millimeters. The apparatus, the mold has got the internal diameter equal to 101.6 millimeter, and the height is equal to 116.8 millimeters. And when you calculate the volume, it will be 945 ml. So in our next class, we shall discuss the test procedure as is required. So I stop at this stage. Thank you very much and good luck and study well.